However, at this point, if you are a cult member that believes rockets exploding are a success, so hold up a moment here. Oh my God, the poor guy. I mean, there's something wrong with his head. This is obviously a reference to the recent Starship second test flight, in which a number of major new milestones were achieved. New launch pad cooling system, major success. Hot stage separation, major success. Huge milestones ticked off. But if you happen to be a cynic and or ironically suffering from mental illness, unless the second ever test flight of this brand new orbital launch system is a flawless success and absolutely everything goes right, it's actually a major failure. This is a level of delusion and derangement of this poor man. Poor Dim Chanos here, suggesting that you must be a deluded cult member to think that the iterative rocket design process, huge new milestones for SpaceX, was not a success. I mean, the guy's just absolutely deluded. It seems almost personal and it seems very emotive. He continues, by the way. So if you're a cult member who believes that a huge success is a huge success, a convicted securities fraudster, or a, quote, short seller that blew up his short fund in the fall of 2008, please sit down and shut the f*** up. Your ignorance and resentment is tiresome. Oh my God. The irony. This is, September 2017.
You had said in June that you would give up the short once Tesla begins making money, and the prediction.
So this is famed short seller Dim Chanos, just over 6 years ago, who had said that he would stop shorting Tesla's stock once the company began printing money. A man of integrity, I'm sure Jim did exactly that. After all, if the financial situation of a company you're currently betting against changes dramatically in a positive direction, continuing to short said company may not be the best idea. And Jim's a very smart guy, so obviously he followed through on that statement and stopped shorting Tesla's stock once they started making money, right?
In the works here.
Well, 3 years ago, Scarlett, this company was supposed to be making money now. And now it's supposed to be making money by 2020. And I'm guessing, you know, by 2019, we'll hear about 2025.
So just wanted to point something out. Jim claiming that Tesla would be claiming that they would eventually be making money and pushing that date out further and further into the future. Well, Jim, I'm here to tell you that you were off by about half a decade on when Tesla would become a profitable company. So obviously, given this amazing era of judgment, new data, you really would imagine that Jim would have exited his short position against Tesla, given the fact that he thought that they wouldn't be making money until mid this decade, essentially an entire decade after these comments were made, yet they started printing money soon after this segment went to air and are printing billions of dollars per quarter.
Company is structurally unprofitable.
So again, aged like a fine bottle of milk. Almost 2 years later, 15th of June, 2018.
How much longer can you keep the Tesla short on?
Oh, I think most short positions you can keep on indefinitely. There's no time frame on them. It's just a matter of price and your willingness to hold and either take temporary losses or book profits. So there's no time frame on a short sale.
And Jim, what's your take on the fact that Elon Musk has just bought more shares? Does that alter your conviction at all in wanting to be short? And in particular, his comments, his actions of the last couple of months, I guess you could say his negative comments towards analysts and the media for criticizing him. What's your take on all of that?
Well, I mean, I think it's interesting. More interesting was the fact that he had an annual meeting last week. And as usual for Tesla, lots of predictions were made and lots of futuristic, shall we say, hype. But somehow the company and its leader could not see the immediate future and see the layoffs that they were about to announce a few days later. So again, it's often this matter of it's about the future. It's about keeping investors focused on some point out in the future.
Oh my God, the irony, bro. The poor guy. I feel bad for this dude. It is true that typically Tesla is a very forward-looking company. You remember how back in 2006, literally before some people watching this channel were even born, Tesla published the trollingly titled Secret Tesla Motors Master Plan and explained their long-term vision over the next few decades. Start at the high end with high-priced, low-volume vehicles, drive costs down, and for medium price, medium volume, then high volume, low price. Like, they literally laid out their whole master plan, a multi-decade master plan. So yes, it is true. Tesla continues to refocus investors on the long term. This is, of course, Jim Chanos, the same guy who, what, about 2 years earlier in a clip, boldly predicted that Tesla wouldn't start making profits until 2025 at minimum. He was off by about half a decade. So one data point that Jim's ability to make long-term predictions not so great. Perhaps he's blinded by the short term. But don't worry, I'm sure he eventually figured out that betting against Tesla was a bad idea, right? I mean, after all, this is still mid-2018, long time ago.
When they hope the company will be profitable. But the fact of the matter is the company is not profitable from operations. The company will pull out all the stops. It will do a lot of one-time items, we believe, to show a GAAP profit in the third quarter. But they are just that, one-time items. And the basic problem is that he's making the cars at not enough of a gross margin to make money. And that's before the competition rolls out, which is late this year.
You heard it here first, folks. Mid-2018, Jim Chanos explaining that the competition is coming late 2018. And also perhaps failing to understand that in order for Tesla to reach profitability, they needed to first scale, which they've done over the long term. And they told us they would do. It's just the poor guy, bro. Anyway, I'm sure he'll figure out that his thinking was a bit faulty and have exited his short position soon after this interview went to air.
In early next year.
December of that same year. Approximately when the competition was finally going to come for Tesla instead of embarrassingly fast all over themselves. Let's see what Jim has to say now that the competition's finally come.
Mr. Musk and Tesla has a broad interpretation of the truth.
Now, call me crazy. It's probably true. But when I hear comments like this, a suggestion of dishonesty, deception, a lack of transparency, lying, misleading, deceiving, almost fraud. Given how well I know Tesla company and Elon Musk, his nature as a person, I immediately become aware that the person making these claims has a very, very poor read on the character of Elon Musk and is for some strange reason blinded to reality. They're deluded, they're hallucinating, they're seeing things such as dishonesty where there is none. And if you happen to be suffering from this form of delusion and or mental illness, you may be prone to making major investing mistakes like betting against the company because you think they're lying to you and misleading and committing fraud. Of course, I don't know what I'm talking about, and Jim's a really good judge of character, actually. But in all seriousness, when you hear these kind of comments, if this is part of the thesis as to why you're betting against Tesla and or any Elon Musk-led company, I just have to be honest, you have the emotional IQ of a potato. You might do very well in an IQ test, but to misread somebody's character so completely is a reflection of something seriously broken in your brain. And I do say that sincerely. Big red flag. Just remember, folks, these same people with very broken radars thinking Elon Musk was a fraud praised Trevor Milton as the second coming of the flying spaghetti monster. Not even kidding. Shout out to Tesla Sharts.
There have been all kinds of announcements that this company has made just in flippant comments that are public statements that turned out not to be true. For example, most recently, he unveiled the Tesla Semi. And the Roadster. And he said the Semi will be available in 2019, the Roadster in 2020. Where is he producing those? Those production lines have to be up and approved now, years before we get final production.
But there are companies like Pepsi who are happy to give them the money now to reserve that. What do you think those announcements are all about?
Yeah, so again, we've got to draw the distinction between being late on production versus being dishonest. Just for the record, PepsiCo, I absolutely fucking love their Tesla semis. They've been touting the benefits, showing them off. It's taken a long time to ramp them up. Tesla's battery constrained. Took a while. The Roadster, that's going to be a while. But at the time of this announcement, Tesla always intended on meeting these deadlines. This is very different from being dishonest. Like, for example, dishonest would be having a fake truck on stage, claiming it was a real truck, making false statements about energy density, the battery pack, potential range, and so on, doubling down on those statements, claiming it's a real truck when it's not, rolling said truck down a hill and filming it, pretending it was propelling itself. That would be an example of actual dishonesty and deception. Missing a deadline, an aggressive deadline, entirely different matter. But again, if you are a little bit blinded by your own biases, perhaps a little bit cynical, you'll see nothing but dishonesty where, in fact, you had transparency. It's very important to understand. A big portion of Jim's thesis here is Tesla has very aggressive deadlines and timelines and doesn't always meet them. Therefore, they're committing fraud. They're lying to you. They're a dishonest company. You got to wonder about the poor guy. Is it possible he's seeing everything through cynical glasses?
About being green and showing their customers. You know, Mercedes-Benz has electric semis on the roads right now testing. You don't hear them crowing about this every day. You don't see the CEO, coming out. They're on the roads testing. And so it's not as if electric semi-cabs are new. They've been out. And so it's remarkable that this company keeps hyping things that are all the way out. I was in Detroit yesterday spent the day, the evening before, with some auto execs and talking about this. And you know, they're sort of shaking their heads because already Detroit has leapfrogged Tesla in autonomy.
Me, dude. I can't even respond to this, brother. If I didn't know any better, I'd think that, in all seriousness, that Dim Chanos here was suffering from some kind of mental illness, legitimate delusion, to the point where he's just beyond help, beyond reason, completely closed off to any contrary indicators. No counter evidence at all. Nothing could possibly change his mind. He's decided Elon's a fraud, Tesla's shit, they're a dishonest company, their products suck, the competition's already here, everyone's ahead of them, and nothing you say could ever change my mind, therefore I'm going to remain short Tesla stock indefinitely until I blow up my hedge fund. But I'm sure that wouldn't actually have happened, right? Early April 2020, at which point Tesla was printing ridiculous amounts of money half a decade before Jim thought they would be. Finally, he announces he's realized he was wrong and changed his mind and exited his short position, right?
You said, you know, one thing that makes it hard to stay short is when a stock gets creamed, like some of the energy ones have done and like Luckin has done today, where you've covered it all. The other is when a stock goes parabolic, like Tesla did over the winter. Are you still short that? And how did that impact your thinking on your positioning?
So Tesla, and we told clients in January, February, that the three-month period, sort of November, December, January, was one of the craziest periods I've ever seen in my 40 years on Wall Street. And if you remember, and I know Josh saw some of this stuff and maybe some of your other panelists, retail for some reason came pouring into the market in individual names and individual stories in a way we haven't seen really since sort of January, February of 2000 at the end of the dot-com boom. And we saw the parabolas. We saw the Teslas, the Virgin Galactics, and others. And we saw it in the data of retail trading at E-Trade and options and Robinhood and so on and so forth. And I had not seen, that was the one thing that had been missing in this bull market in the 10 years, was just manic speculation.
So again, just a little bit of context. Years prior, Dim Chanos claiming that Tesla won't be making any money, won't make it in profit until at least 2025. Then after the company does in fact start turning a profit, half a decade before his high confidence prediction, and just so happens that Tesla stock surges around that same time. And it is true that in the wake of the scamdemic, there are a lot of people piling into certain stonks. But where is the accountability for Jim in terms of, well, I expected Tesla will be making profits in 2025. It turns out they're actually 5 years early. That was part of my thesis as to why I'm still shorting the stock. I was very wrong on that, so I've reassessed my thesis. Did we hear this from Jim, or did the goalposts continue to move?
By individuals. Well, sure enough, by January, February, we had it. And, you know, we saw these stocks go parabolic. And if you're parabolic and you're short, obviously your position's getting much bigger. So in situations like that, if we like the name, like we like Tesla, we will have to cover some if it goes through our risk parameters, but then we will sell it even back down if we want to keep a maximum position. Again, one of the challenges of the short side is that you get bigger when it goes against you and you get smaller when it goes your way. We are still basically maximum short Tesla.
All right, so again, the poor guy, a major part of his thesis having been disproven, Tesla printing money half a decade ahead of his own predictions, despite his anus getting absolutely destroyed, the guy just doubles down and continues to remain maximum short Tesla stock without re-examining some of his prior predictions, comparing them to what actually took place and considering whether or not he's capable of making accurate long-term predictions about this company. Now, you have to remember, ladies and gentlemen, potential losses, short selling, are infinite. This is not true for being long. If you're long a stock and it goes to zero, you lose 100% of your investment. If you're short a stock and it goes to infinity, you have infinite losses. So there's asymmetric risk reward when shorting, meaning you better be damn well sure your thesis is watertight and that you're capable of making accurate predictions of what the company itself will do. Because of course, over the short term, the stock could do anything. But if your underlying thesis is on point, you would assume that over a long enough period of time, the market being a voting machine short term, but a weighing machine long term, will reflect the intrinsic value of the company. Yet one of the biggest things that Jim thought would happen with Tesla is them not making any money until mid-decade, which is still years from now, was massively disproven, embarrassingly wrong. I mean, this is one of the fundamental, this is probably far and away the most important pillar of his thesis. This company will not make money for at least another half plus decade. Actually, he said that almost a decade earlier. He was so wrong. Massive margin of error on the most important thing you could possibly be wrong or right about. Yet having been absolutely wrecked, guys, still maximum short on this company, despite the most important part of his thesis being disproven. What's that saying? You can't fix stupid? I'm just kidding. Jim's a very smart guy. January 2023. Dim looking a little bit worse for wear.
You know, I've been saying kind of half tongue-in-cheek that Tesla is a Chinese car company, and it really is. The bulk of its production is there, and we think almost all its profits are generated there. And so you have all kinds of risks now in light of our earlier discussion about the warnings. But on top of that, you have repatriation of capital risk. You have BYD and others just taking massive market share. And Tesla trades at a premium to those companies who are growing faster than they are in China. So if you want to play all these things, there are now lots of ways to do it. If you want to play the growth of EVs in China, you can buy BYD, you can buy NIO, you can buy Li.
Do you own BYD?
So just me or goalposts continue to move? First, it's Tesla won't make profit before 2025. Then it's, the only reason Tesla stock went up is because dumbass retail investors are piling into stonks. Now it's, if you do believe that EVs are the future and you want to actually take advantage of that, there's lots of other things that aren't Tesla that you can buy instead, because I hate Tesla. I just don't even.
No. We own the S&P and the NASDAQ. I don't think it's in the NASDAQ. So if it's in the NASDAQ, we own it. But I just think that it's really, the choices now are increasing, and the bears were wrong on competition. It took a long time to show up.
Okay, so I guess Jim would include himself as a bear. So I guess Jim has just admitted he was wrong. It's fun to do that when we are wrong, by the way. So Jim has admitted 6+ years ago when he was claiming the competition would be coming later that year. Turns out he was very wrong. So he's been extremely wrong by literally half a decade or so on when Tesla would turn a profit. And there's still no credible competition. Yet, at the time of this recording earlier this year, the guy's still short Tesla stock. Very smart investor. I wonder if he has a newsletter I can subscribe to.
But I don't think they're wrong now. I think
the bears were wrong. Very wrong, embarrassingly wrong. In fact, catastrophically wrong on just about everything. But this time is different. We're not wrong anymore. We're right now. We're right, aren't we? We're finally right. We're right now. Yeah. What? Help. I've nearly blown up my hedge fund. Please be right.
The competition is growing and it's here.
15th of September, 2023. Just over 2 months ago.
The previous girl, Tesla, you are still short on, but you...
So 2 months ago, still short Tesla stock, despite the core pillars of his investment thesis consistently being disproven over time. As in, the guy continues to get turkey slapped in the face with reality and in response says, harder, daddy. I mean, whatever you're into, Jim.
Using options, yes?
We are. We're short the stock, and we just think it's ridiculously overvalued.
Right, but betting against it has not worked out yet. What do you think would
I've noticed.
Right. What do you think would prompt the market to be convinced of your take that Tesla is just a car company, nothing?
So once again, as I mentioned earlier, the difference between shorting a stock and being long a stock is as follows. If you're long a stock and your thesis is correct, but the stock market doesn't recognize the intrinsic value for years, half a decade or more, it's totally fine. You can continue to hold. You won't face mounting losses. You only lose money if you sell. This is not the case for shorting, where, as I mentioned earlier, you can have essentially infinite losses. And if you're shorting via puts, they expire. There's a ticking clock. So again, we've got asymmetrical risk reward, meaning you better damn well be sure that your thesis is on point. Otherwise, you're going to get your face ripped off.
Nothing more.
Well, again, the Tesla story keeps changing, right? Every few months, the Tesla faithful trot out a new, it's batteries, it's robo-taxis, now it's AI.
So, this is actually true, but if I'm understanding Jim's meaning correctly, his interpretation of the fact that Tesla continues to expand, evolve, go after new markets, is investing aggressively in new opportunities, pursuing these opportunities, developing new technologies. Jim's interpretation of this is the people who believe Tesla has a positive future are inventing false reasons why Tesla is even more exciting now than it was 12 months ago, as opposed to these people observing the new opportunities Tesla is pursuing. See, when Dim Chanos first started shorting Tesla stock, there was no talk of autonomy. There was certainly no talk of a humanoid robot, and they really didn't have their hands in the AI pie at all. But things change, except if you're Dim Chanos, in which Tesla is still just a car company. And again, I think there's something broken in this guy's brain. This would be like some dimwit looking at Apple years ago, as they're expanding beyond producing personal computers into devices like the iPod, and then the smartphone, and then building the App Store, and claiming that the Apple faithful keep changing the goalposts and making... Bro, the story's changing. Anyway, back to Dim.
And I'm a little bit bemused, having followed the company as long as we've been following it, that Tesla sort of admitted just recently in its full self-driving effort that it had been pursuing sort of the wrong avenue for 7 years, and that it's now going to a different type of software development for the next iteration of full self-driving beta.
So again, the poor bloke, broken brain, doesn't get it. As I mentioned at the time of this interview, poor Dim Chanos has interpreted this as Tesla being behind in the race to solve autonomy. Why? Because they've adjusted their strategy. Now, as I explained at the time, this is actually an extremely bullish sign that Tesla is so far ahead of everyone else that they're figuring out what works and what doesn't. They are pioneering this technology. They are so far ahead. They keep bumping into a roadblock and go, okay, yep, not the right approach. Let's adjust. No one else is even close enough to be realizing the mistakes that are going to be made, that they're going down blind alleys. They need to adjust their strategy. This is hugely bullish for Tesla, and it's indicative of how far ahead they are. Yet poor Dim here thinks, oh, look how dumb they are. They were going in this direction, and now they've adjusted. They've gone from lots of heuristics to no heuristics. They just trained a vehicle to be incredibly capable, just purely on video. This is a huge AI breakthrough, but I'm going to think that it's evidence that they're behind. Oh, man, you poor guy. Someone really needed to stage an intervention years ago.
And so... I'm just sort of wondering, this technological leader just told you that they basically were, you know, doing the wrong thing for 7 years.
Yeah.
Now, my problem with that is they've been selling it as a product. They've been selling full self-driving since 2016.
So should we tell him that the customers purchasing this software are doing so of their own volition? It's a product. This is very clear about its capabilities at the time. And customers who want those capabilities purchase the software. It's a free market, Jim. People are making choices. It just doesn't make any sense that Jim has a problem with a company selling a product to consumers, explaining what the product is capable of doing, consumers who want the product, willing to pay for it, paying for it, and this being a problem. And now, a recent post on X from the very man himself, whose username, interestingly, on X is Wall Street Cynic. For those of you unaware, the definition of a cynic: a person who believes that people are motivated purely by self-interest rather than acting for honorable or unselfish reasons. One more time. Cynic: a person who believes that people are motivated purely by self-interest rather than acting for honorable or unselfish reasons. So, let's think about this, folks. Think about the psychology of somebody who dubs themselves, identifies themselves literally, has the username Wall Street Cynic, as in somebody who is extremely cynical, believing that, in general, just about everyone on Wall Street, everyone in every company on Wall Street, all CEOs are self-interested and will never be doing something just to be doing good. Just imagine the psychology of somebody who identifies as Wall Street Cynic. Is it possible that such a person could potentially be blinded by their biases and their perception that literally everyone is motivated by self-interest rather than acting for honorable or unselfish reasons? And is it possible that such a person may make extremely foolish assessments of the motivations of people leading companies and then perhaps bet against these companies based on a faulty thesis, having been blinded by their identification as a cynic, to the point where no matter what they look at, no matter what they see, no matter what the actual motivations are, they see nothing but self-interest? Nah, that would never happen. What am I talking about? I'm so dumb. Speaking of dumb, I mean, what? No, that was a really bad segue. I don't know why I said that. It's got nothing to do with dumb. So, from this very rational actor, for those of you asking why I don't address some of my harshest critics directly on this harmonious site, next level trolling, please understand that I give those with clear signs of mental illness wide berth And you should too. Now, I absolutely agree with this, ladies and gentlemen. One, don't feed the trolls. And two, never argue with an idiot. There's no point. And obviously, if somebody's showing clear signs of mental illness, what's the point? But wait, there's more. What an honor for this post to have made one of my only 11 bookmarks. However, at this point, if you are a cult member that believes rockets exploding are a success, so hold up a moment here. Oh my God, the poor guy. I mean, there's something wrong with his head. This is obviously a reference to the recent Starship second test flight, in which a number of major new milestones were achieved. New launch pad cooling system, major success. Hot stage separation, major success. Huge milestones ticked off. But if you happen to be a cynic and or ironically suffering from mental illness, unless the second ever test flight of this brand new orbital launch system is a flawless success and absolutely everything goes right, it's actually a major failure. This is a level of delusion and derangement of this poor man. So let me be clear. If this was a Falcon 9 launch of some Starlink satellites and the Falcon 9 blew up on the launch pad or didn't deploy the payload, this would definitely be a failure because it's an established, proven launch system. The thing that poor Dim Chanos here either fails to understand or intentionally chooses to pretend he doesn't understand is that in order for you to develop a new rocket, a new launch system, new technologies, hot staging separation, figuring out how to land these things, you need to launch and iterate. It's an iterative process. It's insane, asinine, to think that the very first time you launch one of these things, everything goes perfectly. The reason that you launch them is to learn, collect data, and improve. The very first Starship flight absolutely nuked the launch pad. Huge amount of learnings. Now, entirely new launch pad system, no problems this time. The first launch didn't make it to its intended altitude. There was damage to some of the engines. There was a problem, didn't have enough thrust, had to terminate. A success for the following launch would be A, having a new system to protect the launch pad and not nuking it. Huge success, that's exactly what happened. Making it further, huge success. In fact, all engines actually worked on the way up. And if lucky, maybe a bonus would be also being able to test the hot staging separation, which is exactly what happened. But poor Dim Chanos here, suggesting that you must be a deluded cult member to think that the iterative rocket design process, huge new milestones for SpaceX, was not a success. I mean, the guy's just absolutely deluded. It seems almost personal, and it seems very emotive. He continues, by the way. So if you're a cult member who believes that a huge success is a huge success, a convicted securities fraudster, or a, quote, short seller that blew up his short fund in the fall of 2008, I don't know who he's referring to here. Could it be Andrew Citron? I don't know. He's probably referring to somebody who previously shorted Tesla stock and has flipped. Let me know in the comments below if anyone understands who he's referring to then. Please sit down and shut the f*** up. Your ignorance and resentment is tiresome. Oh my God. The irony. This is, the irony. I just don't know how else to say this, guys. Have you ever seen the pot call the kettle black? You know, I heard a quote a long time ago. People will never say or do anything to you that isn't a direct reflection of themselves. I don't know why I mentioned that. It's completely unrelated. Anyway, I just thought I'd share this excellent example of a very intelligent person whose investment thesis has been absolutely spot on from day one, who just got really unlucky. So unlucky, in fact, that assets under management have collapsed from a peak of $6 billion to about $200 million, so roughly 3% of the peak value. And we've recently heard now that this very, very smart investor slash pathological cynic is closing down his hedge funds. Of course, I'm pretty confident that this guy is never, ever going to admit his thesis was off. Now, again, I want to be really clear. There can be long periods of time where the stock market, so to speak, doesn't recognize the intrinsic value of a company. So I'm sure Jim's just going to continue doubling down. Well, they're still just a car company. They're only producing 10,000 robots a month. They're only licensing FSD to 25 million other vehicles on the planet. They're still just a car company. It's still overvalued anyway. And plus the competition's coming. Haven't you seen the Boston Dynamics humanoid robots? And Cruise has now deployed 3 robo-taxis in 2 different cities. But retail investors are dumb. I'm pretty sure that he's going to go to his grave thinking that Tesla's a shitty company. They only make vehicles. Elon Musk is a fraudster. And unfortunately, unlike certain YouTube personas, I think Jim's hubris and arrogance is actually entirely genuine and incurable. So, in short, don't be Dim Chanos. Unless, of course, you have a humiliation fetish, in which case, carry on. I won't judge you. Whatever you're into, it's fine by me. Ouch. Want more content? Early access? bunch of perks, click the links in the pinned comment. AG1 has given me a massive, meaningful boost in energy, allowing me to do a lot more every day, including using my brain more and using my body more. I highly recommend you guys and girls check it out. It's an excellent way to fill in nutritional gaps. It's got 75 high-quality vitamins, minerals, and whole food source nutrients, plus prebiotics and probiotics and digestive enzymes and adaptogens to help you deal with stress. Plus, if you click the link in the pinned comment or head to drinkag1.com/smr, you can get yourself a one-year free supply of vitamin D3 and K2. But don't take my word for it. Here's what some of you guys and girls have to say. AG1 has changed my life. I was, as you described, treating myself like a circus, ate like trash, rarely exercised, used alcohol as a stress crutch, cannabis also. AG1 is what gave me the kick in the ass, got me back to the gym, motivated me to do more for myself, family, my business, etc. Keep doing what you do. Now, I know there's some skeptics, the same kind of people who think Elon Musk is a fraud, reading this going, "What do you thought? There's no way that's possible, bro. It must be a placebo effect." Believe it or not, this is a recurring theme. If you give your body everything it needs to feel and perform its best, including having a lot more energy, you'll need ways to use that energy. For me personally, that includes more exercise, moving my body more, more social activity, and more cognitively demanding tasks, including producing a fuck ton of exclusive content over on Twitter and on Patreon, plus my daily YouTube uploads. The proof's in the pudding. On to another testimonial from a viewer of this channel. SMR, you asked me to provide feedback on AG1. Here it is. It has helped with mental acuity, stamina, and intestinal waste management. Can't read between the lines. It certainly helps with regularity and digestion. That's what the digestive enzymes are for. It has also dramatically reduced my cravings for sugar. You guys need to stop eating sugar. It's fucking poison. I'm 50, 5'9", and overweight, aka a fat motherfucker. I think that's a technical term for overweight, isn't it? Is it fat motherfucker or obese? I can't remember. I average 100 hours a week in the West Texas oil fields as a safety supervisor. Jesus Christ, dude. No wonder you're struggling to keep your weight under control. 100 hours a week. Brutal. It has helped me lose weight. It is not an appetite suppressant. It can help fat people suppress cravings, and motivation to be healthier is critical for changing your diet. Love you, brother. Again, this is a great point and something people really don't seem to grasp. If you have more energy, everything becomes easier. It's like turning on easy mode for life. A few years ago, before I was taking AG1, my health was trash. I was struggling to get through the day, had afternoon fatigue. The last thing I wanted to do was either use my brain or move my body. Didn't have the energy. Now, my biggest struggle every day is figuring out ways to use that energy. I'm exercising way more, doing a lot more with my friends and family, and of course, my work output has increased substantially. And you can fact check me. Check out the average length of my videos I was posting to YouTube 3 years ago. Need I say more? And one final testimonial. Love this one. Okay, here's the deal for me with this AG1 shit. I'm 41 years old and not the type to eat, drink, smoke, or sleep healthy, so I was skeptical. That being said, here's what I experienced. Day one, meh. Day two, afternoon fatigue was about 45 minutes late. Day three, zero afternoon fatigue. Day four, zero afternoon fatigue plus extra energy. Day five, again, zero afternoon fatigue plus energy. Wondering, what the fuck, really? See, this is the thing, right? The results for many people are just almost too good to be true. This is the same experience I had. My afternoon fatigue just vanished out of nowhere. I'm like, wait, what the fuck? Why am I not tired in the afternoons anymore? Surely, it's not that AG1 shit, is it? Turns out it was. Day six and seven, same thing. Day eight, same thing. Plus, I had the want to get things done around the house that I normally would slack off and not get done. Again, the point, extra energy, you'll need to use it. You'll find ways to use it. Day 9, 10, and 11, and today is day 12. I fucking love it. So however you managed to get me to buy it, I'm so glad you did. Thank you so much, SMR. It really changed me so far. Guys, this shit really works. Just try it. By the way, this is the reason I continue to relentlessly promote AG1. A lot of people get real fucking mad in the comments.
Oh my God, snake oil salmon sold out. Oh my God, he's a scammer. This is fraud. But
constantly, I'm pretty sure everyone making these comments is also currently short Tesla stock. I'm not particularly concerned about people having a negative perception, those folks suffering from small brain syndrome, still living in my bum's basement syndrome, etc., writing mean comments, claiming AG1's a scam or it doesn't work. I mean, bro. When I get feedback like this, this is what keeps me going. Just try this stuff for a month, and if you don't get these results, get your money back. See, it's a literal no-brainer. It's an IQ test at this point in time. Testimonial after testimonial after testimonial like this. Get your money back if it doesn't work. Just try it for a month, and if it doesn't work, get your money back. Today's the day. It's finally time. Be like this guy who was a massive skeptic, but finally, after 1,000 promotions in a row, caved in, tried AG1, and has results like this. Head to drinkag1.com/smr or click the link in the pinned comment, and please, let me know how you're feeling in a few weeks' time. Now, if you'll excuse me, time to put my extra energy to good use. I'll be recording some more exclusive content for Patreon and my Twitter subscribers. So click the links in the pinned comment, see you over on Twitter and or Patreon, and don't forget to grab your AG1. Love ya.